if you look at psychology, I mean, and we say black psychology, some people call, say, Saku. I mean, when we look at these concepts, when we go backwards in terms of our history to sort of find a standing place, what we discover is that the African people had already developed many notions of the mind long before we encountered the West, before the Greeks came to these notions of the mind, particularly concepts that they came out with like logos and pathos and ethos and so forth, that Africa had at its root notions such as Mat, for example, Sarujta. I mean, many notions that were very basic. And if we could grapple with those notions and understand those notions, we would have some understanding.
The African psychology is the only psychology that the first attempt by human beings to understand the spirit and human functioning was done in ancient Kemet, or what people call Egypt.
Most of the major ethnic groups from the Senegal River in the north to the Congo River in the south can trace their origins to the Nile Valley, beginning about 650 BC or thereabouts, when the first of five migrations left the Nile Valley, moving westward into Western Africa. So that when you look at ethnic groups that we are familiar with, whether it be the Wolof and the Lebu of Senegal, whether it be the Akan of Ghana, whether it be the Ewe of Togo or the Fon of Benin or the Yoruba of Nigeria, all of them and others can trace their origins back to the Nile Valley. That means they can trace their systems, their spiritual systems. You might even say their psychological systems and mythical systems and symbolic systems also back to the Nile Valley.
And as we go back and then reclaim some of that African culture, and begin to study and embrace some of the ideology that came out of those ancient Kemetic and historically African places, what we know is that our discipline of psychology is really thousands of years old, not just, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50, or even 100 years old, and in fact traverses a landscape from historical contemporary times all the way back even into ancient Kemetic spaces.
Way later on, some several thousand years later, Europeans begin to talk about a psychology, and which really was an armchair philosophy that later on became based on laboratory, and it became, quote, scientific psychology. But all that is very recent. The original psychology was in ancient Egypt, or ancient Kemet, by black people.
It was also the ancient Kemetic Egyptians, those indigenous peoples of Africa, who came down the Nile and created that civilization. They also not only knew about the unconscious mind, they also knew about the superconscious mind, the mind that is above the unconscious mind and subsumes the conscious mind. And they mapped it out in exquisite detail. If you look at the clinical work and also the scholarship of both Freud and Jung, they mention this in different ways.
Jung investigated the concept of what he called the collective unconscious, where everything in the spiritual life of human beings takes place, and it fuels everything that happens in the conscious world. And it connects to all of what he called the mythological and symbolic constructs that human beings have created over the millennia, so that all religion, all symbolism, all mythology, all derives from the actions of the collective unconscious. So that's the reason why Jung, and to a lesser extent Freud, were fascinated by the psychomythic systems of traditional and tribal peoples.
And if you look at both of those and what they're talking about and their own statements about it, it brings you inevitably back to the ancient Kemetic Egyptians who studied the unconscious and called it by name.
To the extent that you're talking about a black psychology based on systems, cosmological systems, world systems that are in West Africa, ultimately these are ancient Kemetic systems once removed. So that when you think about any African system today, it all ramifies back to ancient Kemet.
The ancient Kemetic Egyptians outlined that the world was basically alive. Each individual consciousness was part of a much larger web, and that this web continued to transform itself. The whole art and science of mummification, the basis of that was the not only the belief, but the perception and the experience that consciousness transforms itself, not only from the waking state to the dreaming state, but also to the post-mortem state.
The pyramids were actually designed by priests. They were designed by people whose study was of the soul.
In fact, there is a huge scene in the pyramids. It's called the psychostasis. And the psychostasis is that scene some of you know about where you have the initiate being judged by the netters or by the gods and the weighing of his heart against the feather of Ma'at. That is an ancient scene. It's called the psychostasis. And in that scene, the interpretation of it is that man or woman must go through a judgment of their righteousness. And when they are found wanting, they have to be taught the right way. And the right way is what we call therapy. I have made the argument that scene was called the Saku. And the Saku is really the word that was bastardized by the Greeks to become the Psyche. And the Psyche becomes a study of the spirit or psychology, but it really was Saku, which was the illumination of the spirit. And in illuminating the human spirit, one was able to understand the transitions and the transformations of humanity.
And so in African psychology, what we have tried to do is go back across space and time. Space meaning what is central to North Africa, Central, South, West, and East Africa. Across time, meaning what is consistent in ancient Kemetic, historically African, and contemporary African-American spaces that allow us as Black psychologists to go back and reclaim some of those traditions and customs and worldview that are part and parcel of our own cultural tradition. And that to me is where African psychology has evolved and what it represents today as a series of constructs and principles that are more consistent with an African-centered ideology.
In the European psychological tradition, the human being is defined with reference to their internal psychological attributes, such as their thoughts and emotions. In other words, the goal of becoming a human being then is to individuate, is to separate from other people and find who you are internally and define yourself independently of your surroundings. Now, this differs markedly from an indigenous African psychological perspective, whereby the goal of becoming a human being is to find connections. The goal of becoming a human being is to respond to the energies that are always surrounding you. The vibrations that are out there are an indication that we are all connected to other people.
African psychology is basically a perspective that looks at human beings within the context of how Africans understood the human experience.
I would define African psychology as a system of knowledge encompassing constructs, concepts, paradigms, models, systems of practice, procedures for conduct, etc., a way of knowing the world in reality from the perspective or the vantage point are grounded in African-American culture reality and African culture reality.
African psychology is a way of thinking that is centered in an African worldview. It's essentially the dynamic manifestation of unifying African principles, values, and traditions. Because African psychology says that what makes you a human being is much more than what is proposed in the biopsychosocial model of Western thought.
African psychology begins to build on some of the basic assumptions about the nature of life, the nature of the human being, that is, in fact, indigenous to African people categorically.
So when we think about African-centered psychology, it has certain principles. For example, it recognizes that spirit permeates everything. the notion that everything in the universe is interconnected, the idea that the value of the collective is much more important than the individual. It is not, I think, therefore I am. It is, I am because we are.
And we talk about African psychology, but we are talking about it from not within the system, but out from outside the system and looking at it. So when you start examining not merely the historical framework of ancient African history, but their mythological, spiritual, and symbolic framework, you see that they established those parameters in a way that impacted the rest of the world from then on.
The term psychology was in fact a derivation of psyche, which was in fact a recognition that the psyche was the soul, and that the study of the soul was the original agenda of what the discipline of psychology was all about.
So psychology is just, you might say, it's not just a way of thinking. It's not just mental, whether it's conscious or unconscious. It's a way of being. Now, if you understand it as a way of being, then you begin to get at the essence of what people like to think of as African psychology, which is really what you might call African spiritual systems, or the African world systems is what I like to say.
There are a number of principles that guide spiritual and human existence in the African universe. These principles include the principle of mutuality and complementarity, or those of insufficiency and interdependence. The notion of the factor of incompleteness is used to draw attention to a framework of insufficiency that I believe characterizes the nature of beings in the universe. Nothing in the universe, whether spirits or human beings, can exist on their own in isolation from the others.
A human being cannot be defined from an indigenous African psychological perspective with reference to their psychological attributes only, because that is just a very, very small element of what it means to be human. To be human has to be explained with reference to the idea of ubuntu. Umuntu ngumuntu ngabantu. A human being is a human being because of other human beings.
The concept of ubuntu is translated and explained in different ways. Some people say it means I am because you are, but it also means that I am part of a collective. It means reciprocity. It means I will act to you the way you act to me. It means mutuality, people help each other. So to develop an African psychology is a necessity, because it talks to the cultural experiences of the people. And cultural African psychology is very strong in then talking to these experiences that might be missed in Western psychology.
So the idea of ubuntu then says that you belong in the first instance to your own family, you belong to the community, you belong to your ancestors, and ultimately, you are part of the broader universe.
There are interpenetrating realms of existence. In other words, there's the mundane world of the physical and our current manifestation as human beings, but there's also another realm of existence at the spiritual realm, and that is as real as the mundane world, and that these two worlds interact with each other. These two worlds serve functions and purposes. These two worlds need to be in harmony. And nothing in life, including the human and the spirit, lives in isolation from one another. So we are coexisting, and we are always in connection to each other.
There are three interrelated and interpenetrating worlds that constitute the universe. Among these three worlds are the following: the world above, or the sky world, the world beneath, or the spirit world, and the in-between world, or what is also called the human world, the earthly world. This belief of the intermingling of forces in the human world is also responsible for prayers, for religious rituals, for religious ceremonies. There are so many means by which human beings can communicate or contact the various realms of the universe, according to the African cosmology.
would you might say there is a seamless cosmo connection, which now encompasses everything on earth, everything in the heavens, and indeed the entire universe. The universe is a fabric, and everything in it is kind of connected to everything else.
So at the core of African psychology, at the core of Ubuntu, is the unity of being, that we are all one in spirit.
My argument is that Afrocentricity is a theory that gives African people the conceptual framework from which to discuss and analyze and to critique almost all of phenomena related to African people.
What makes Africa so essential to our understanding of humanity is the fact that that's the only place that we can find the historical foundation for all human culture and civilization. So if we're going to be comprehensive in our orientation, we absolutely have to go back to Africa.
Africa is the mother continent. Africa is the continent where everyone originated, and it is there that people stood up and started asking critical questions about life. Those are questions such as, who am I? What is my relationship to other people, and what is my relationship to the natural environment?
African thought says there are other ways to generate knowledge. There are other ways through which we get information. For example, there's preter-rational knowledge, knowledge that goes beyond logic, it goes beyond rational thought. And that preter-rational knowledge means that I have the ability in my consciousness to access other realms of information that can come to me through dreams. It can come to me through intuition. It can come to me through the ancestors. It can come to me through divination. It can come to me through what we call daimonic thinking. Basically, that there are other ways of gathering information, knowing at the level beyond your senses.
The Sangoma or traditional healer will try and establish where has the person's community gone wrong in terms of their connection between the family and the ancestors. So we'll try and establish where has relatedness been broken.
We think of going beyond the information given. We think of going beyond the ordinary crisis the individual is facing to think about, is there something that is beyond our eyes? They try to involve the Sangoma in South Africa, or the Dibiafa, if it is among the Igbo, to go into divination, to ask, to find out from the ancestors. Because human beings live in a precarious environment populated by invisible spiritual agencies.
Human beings are primarily spiritual beings. That is a fundamental tenet that goes all the way back to Nile Valley civilization, and it is consistent through every culture of Africa.
We actually walk in the world as unique and valuable spirits vibrating in seven different directions. So we don't just walk forward and back, we vibrate in seven different directions.
This is why music is so important. This is why the rhythm is so important, because rhythm and music and dance function to change the vibration of the participants. These vibrations are a way of connecting with your personal deity, as well as the group deity, as the collective deity, as well as the overall, overarching creator from which all things come.
The vibrating in seven different directions may have some import for understanding what kinds of dysfunctional rhythms may need to be addressed.
So it is through the means of not only knowing the vibrations, but feeling the vibrations, enacting the vibrations, that certain kinds of human beings can, as it were, be in touch with beings of another order.
In a pictorial way, when we watch how black people dance, We actually dance, and most of our dances are in seven directions. We may not realize that the tribal dance of moving in seven different directions, vibrating in seven different directions, is the medicine of the bomb that makes us well, at least strong enough to go back and deal with the crises that are in our community. But we haven't looked at ourselves as this African conceptualization of what it means to be a human being. When we start doing that, we start seeing the world differently. And then go to the club and watch black folk do what we do. Or watch the African drummers and see how their beats really give us the impression that feels like, well, I'm backing up, or you know, I'm doing all these dance. These things are the important things for us to look at, because it makes sense once you understand the African meaning of what it means to be a human being. What is real is my spirit. And that spirit is a knowing and knowable trifold vibrating, radiating spirit. And so part of what we are now talking about as psychology is knowing what our spirit knows. Being able to talk to our spirit, being able to understand where that vibrating, radiating energy that we call spirit becomes chaotic. When I get disconnected or shattered, then I see chaotic rhythm. And that chaotic rhythm is best what we call insanity.
That's what trans states are designed to do. You get opened up to the deity, and that deity comes down and inhabits you and displaces your personality for that period of time, because very often the deities will communicate with the community through the individuals that they possess. Second of all, the individual himself or herself might induce possession for reasons that have to do with what he or she needs, particularly in the realm of healing. And then thirdly, it's just a way to bring the deity into the community through possession. And when that happens, the person who is possessed loses all sense of him or herself, has no consciousness of what is happening while it's happening, and when the possession ends, has no memory of it. Because personality and spirit, it has been displaced, you might say, by that of the descending spirit or deity.
It has a way of psychologically cleansing. That's one of the ways in which they treat psychological illness, what we get to call psychological illness.
The way that Africans understand psychological development is a process of transformation, where you become gradually transformed so that you can become an affirmation of that spiritual being that you came here to be. So the idea is that we are in a journey, and the life experience, the physical life experience, is in fact a transition. And it's a period of transformation from spirit back to spirit.